what we covered last time, we were looking at the psychometric chart, and one of the key points on the psychometric chart were these diagonal lines that we had shown over there. So if you've got your charts from last class, you should take them out. We're going to be using them for the exercises in the lecture today. And what we had said is one way we can conceptually understand some of those diagonal lines on the chart is to see it from this perspective of a container. There's a container which is an AI value container. In other words, all the energy is in the system. There's no energy moving through those walls. Any change in the heat transfer must come from the system itself. And we had looked at this conceptual case where I've had inlet gas coming in at some temperature T and a particular humidity psi. So if we go back to our psychometric chart, that chart is simply a representation of T on horizontal axis, in your case, measured in Celsius. And on the vertical axis is psi humidity, and that's kilograms of water per kilogram dry air. Okay, so it's a mass over mass basis. And you'll notice those numbers on the vertical axis are relatively small, indicating the very low amount of water vapor that air can hold. It's not a very it's not a great medium for holding water. Okay? So those numbers on the vertical axis are low. And if we plot that inlet gas, we are at some point on the graph T and psi. So at that point there's T psi coordinate for a given point. If that inlet gas goes into this container and we've got water that's being atomized or sprayed in over there, the air is going to take up water. So provided this humidity psi here is not at saturation, we can still load additional moisture into that air, and if we do so, we will reach equilibrium saturation, and that airstream leaving then will be at some different humidity psi and at some lower temperature T. We established last class that it's at lower temperature T, at some temperature Ts, and at some humidity psi S. It was at a lower temperature because the energy to move this water from the liquid phase to the vapor phase, we need some energy to do that, and that energy comes from the system itself, and so the stream leaving must be at a lower temperature, Ts. What we're interested in is those diagonal lines along which we move. If you come in at this temperature and you move to a lower temperature, there's any number of ways you can move from this point to that point. Okay. But when it comes to psychometrics, it's always along the straight line connecting T to Ts, and that slope then is a very particular number, and then we derived that at the end of the class last time. So from a simple enthalpy balance across the system, we can then derive a change in humidity divided by a change in temperature. That's going to be equal to Cs. Look at Cs again. Humid heat. Okay, so Cs is a measure of the heat capacity of the water air mixture and divided by delta HVAP, the heat, the latent heat to vaporize from liquid to vapor. So those numbers, the denominator is a function of temperature, the numerator is a function of humidity psi. Okay, so those diagonal lines can be calculated and they're relatively constant. So for a given system, those lines you'll notice are roughly parallel. So let's work through an example then. Take this as a case and consider this system here, where we've got air coming in at 70 Celsius with a particular amount of moisture. What is the percentage humidity of the incoming stream, percentage humidity of the stream leaving, humidity of the airstream? So answer those three questions, and you may even get to part 4 and 5. So it shouldn't take you more than a few minutes to answer these based on those psychometric chart you have.
supposed to be 55 grams, not 40 grams?
55 grams of water.
Saturated, it's leaving at 100% humidity, from the definition of saturated. Part 3, the humidity mass over mass of the airstream leaving.
65 grams per kilogram.
65 grams per kilogram. Other answers? Does that look right, sound right? How did we get 65? Everyone clear on that? Sorry? You want to know how we got to 65? Okay, we'll look at that in a minute. Temperature of the airstream leaving? 45 degrees. Yes? No? Okay. So there's some of the answers there. 20% incoming humidity, 100%. 65 grams per kilogram, 66 grams per kilogram, it doesn't matter too much, 45 degrees Celsius. How did we get those numbers? So, percentage humidity of the incoming airstream is, let's take a look. We're at 70 Celsius and, so we're somewhere along this axis here, 70 Celsius and at 0.055, was it? Yeah, okay. So. Somewhere along over there. So the intersection of those gets you, we're on that 20% humidity. So if we're saturated, we're moving at that to saturation. So we're going to move diagonally then. Let's just put a different color here. If we're moving diagonally, we go along that point of intersection at 20%. And okay, So we're moving along that curve to that point. When we get to that point, we can then read horizontally across, and we get 65-66 grams per kilogram. And then we can read down and see what that temperature is, and it's 45 degrees. So we cool it, that air comes in at 70 degrees Celsius, but because it's taking up more moisture, it's going from 55 to 65 grams, that moisture goes into the air, we go vaporize that into the liquid phase. From the liquid phase to the vapor phase, we lose some heat, and that means we do drop from 70 Celsius to 45. So there's always a little bit of play around those numbers. Okay, and then finally, because from a mass balance perspective, you can do an overall mass balance and calculate that you need 11 grams per minute to make up that water that's being taken up by the
vapor.
The percentage humidity of the airstream leaving is this temperature of this stream leaving here. But so we're taking it to equilibrium in the problem statement, so to saturation. So if it's in here, you're atomizing this vapor, so it will come to 100% humidity in a closed system given enough time. There will be an equilibrium between the liquid and the vapor, so it's totally saturated. In an open system, you won't come to equilibrium in 100%. So try this at home next time. Take a bottle of water, put it half full in the fridge, close the screw cap tightly, or glass works really well rather than plastic, and you will observe the water droplets on the condensing on the vapor side, above the water interface, and there's perfectly equilibrium.
Doesn't the atmosphere at times be 20% humidity?
Doesn't the
atmosphere at times be 20% humidity?
Yeah, but most times it's not. Okay, so let's take a look at two more definitions. The wet bulb temperature is one that you've seen in some of your chemistry classes or physics perhaps. So wet bulb temperature says, this is an important one to understand. Let's just take a look at this diagram here. If we zoom in on this wet bulb thermometer, there's actually two thermometers in there. This lower one is measuring ordinary dry bulb temperature. The one above it, it's covered with a piece of cotton or material that's soaked in water. And what we do is we take this device, and on that hinge over there, we swing it around really rapidly. So we create a very high velocity around that thermometer. The bottom thermometer will always just read the ambient dry bulb temperature. The one above it, though, that water in the cotton is going to start to evaporate. You start to swing it around, and the temperature on this second or this top thermometer will drop, will be lower because that water is evaporating. And what we're doing is we simply say, provided we keep the water there in excess and it keeps on evaporating that water, we're measuring the temperature right at that interface of evaporation. And that's the wet bulb temperature. So it's also defined then, if you read it up on wherever you choose to get your definitions from, the temperature the parcel of air would have if cooled to saturation. So right there at that interface between the material and the thermometer, there's evaporation taking place, and it's totally at saturation. You're going from liquid to vapor, and the latent heat is being supplied by that system. So it's essentially measuring the temperature where evaporation is occurring. This is our crucial number we're going to be dealing with in all our drying studies, because I'll show you in a minute how drying occurs from a molecular point. That temperature where the liquid vaporizes is our temperature difference is going to be our driving force. So the wet bulb temperature is crucial to us. Now, you can calculate that wet bulb temperature theoretically from doing an energy balance around that thermometer tip, and it can be done. It gets a little bit messy. It goes into all sorts of correlations. But what's really interesting, and it's kind of surprising how it works, but the wet bulb temperature is got exactly the same slope on the psychrometric chart as this adiabatic saturation curve. So if we go back to these slope curves on the psychrometric chart, the wet bulb temperature is in fact follows this exact same line. You simply read down to this tip point here and you read down, that also happens to be the wet bulb temperature. It's very surprising that the adiabatic saturation curves land up to be exactly the same slope as for the wet bulb temperature, only for water in air. If you were dealing with other organic solvents in air, the slope for the wet bulb temperatures is quite different. But for water, we can get by with using just one chart with these one set of slopes. So what we can do next is just one more definition, and then I'll give you another problem to solve. Let's one final quantity we're going to require is what's called the unit volume. It's simply the inverse of the density of a moist air. So again, this is derived very similar to the previous definition for the heat capacity of the humid heat. The humid volume is derived very much in the same way. It's a composition of the density of the air plus the density of the moisture in the air. And that's a function of the humidity and the dry bulb temperature. And you can look up these formulas for how they're derived if you're interested. By and large, though, VH, just to bear in mind and a good check if you've done your calculations correctly, will always be in the order of 1. Okay, so the density of air is 1 kilogram per meter cubed. So the humid volume is 1 meter cubed per kilogram. And because air holds so little moisture, this density of air doesn't change very much, either if it's perfectly dry air or if it's very humid air, this number is still within the range of 1. Okay, so here's an example for you to try it out, and you can prove to yourself that you get a number close to 1 over there. Key point though is that when you use the dry bulb temperature here, it must be in Kelvin, not in Celsius. Humidity is on the regular kilogram per kilogram basis. So psi over here in this example was 0.036. You can use it as it, but temperature must be in Kelvin. So here's another example for you to try out. See if you can calculate these six quantities for a given air at 55 degrees Celsius, 1 atmosphere, and a humidity of 0.03 kilograms per kilogram. You should be able to get this in 2 minutes, or those, 2-3 minutes for all those quantities. It's a quick. It's the opposite of what the density of air. The density of air changes, temperature, density of moisture changes, temperature and moisture size, then
Thank you.
So if you need more psychometric charts, that are all the PDF is posted on the course website. So substituting the value for psi, then you'll get CS then of 1.061 kilojoules. Okay, so CS is straight from the formula. Yes? No? Oh, 31. Okay, let's take a look at that in a minute. Yeah, okay. VH, again, any answers that differ from VH here? Okay, so VH again is from a formula that we just saw on the previous slide, noting that your temperature needs to be in Kelvin. Okay, and then wet bulb temperature 36. So let's see, maybe I have an error. Yeah, so we'll take a look at both the dew point and the wet bulb temperature now. So air at 55 Celsius, just want to make a note of this, and 0.03. So we're at 55 Celsius. We're somewhere along there, and 0.03. Okay, so there's your 25% humidity is interpolated between the 20 and the 30% mark. So that one is straightforward. I asked what the dew point temperature was, so there again we follow that intersection through there, kind of parallel to that line. Where's the Dr. Martin? Okay, I'm not going to get this right. Anyway, so you get the idea though, we're at that point of intersection, we come across here, that's my saturation, come down, that's 35, 36 degrees Celsius.
So that's the
point. Oh, sorry, that's my wet bulb temperature.
That's the wet bulb.
Yeah.
Dew point,
straight across.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, sorry, I was skipping across. Yeah, so dew point is where's our intersection is over here, come across. And down is about at 31. Okay. So someone had said 35. Okay, you're confused. Okay, so let's make sure we're on the same page here. So what I was showing here, this diagonal green line, is the wet bulb temperature. Okay, so you got that calculation down. Let's come back to the dew point. No, the human?
I guess it is.
Okay. So let's take a look then at the dew point temperature. Dew point says read across, so we're simply reading across that point and then down again. So we go to saturation and come back down. You're about 30, 31 degrees. Okay. So this number over here, about 31, or 35. Any other questions on this? This is important to be able to read these things off very quickly. As you'll see in the next example, you're going to need all these numbers to solve typical drying problems, and you cannot be wasting time figuring out where to get your data from. So this is something that you should be able to get really quickly.
Why is it that you go straight across?
Why isn't it that you go straight?
Why is it that you go straight across?
Well, the dew point temperature. Yeah. That's how dew point was applied. It says take an air and cool it down, and where you first start to see the droplets condense out.
Yeah.
That's where it's going.
We
did a few classes back. So if you go back to an earlier slide, it was one of the first definitions.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so dew point, here was a different example, just read horizontally across and down. Yes?
Sorry, so the dew point is the temperature at which the air with that humidity will start to condense.
So you take this air and there's a certain amount of moisture in it, okay? And you cannot see it, it's totally in the vapor phase. You cool that air down to a certain point where you start to see your first droplets of liquid form. That's the dew point.
And is the wet bulb then the same thing as when you do the air flowing through
that adiabatic container?
Yeah. So that's the same as the wet bulb.
It's coincidental though. So that's not how wet bulb temperature is derived, but it's coincidental that you follow that diagonal slope and you go to the point of saturation and it's the same number. So we don't draw another set of diagonal lines on this graph and cycle it up. If you look at psychrometric charts for other solvents, for example, there will be two sets of diagonal lines that are not parallel. Okay, so
it's a different, diagonal line for wet bulb?
For water, it's the same diagonal line. There is only one set of diagonal lines on the psychrometric chart. Okay, so let's take a look at some equipment then in which drying is typically done. So most of my classes, I often show you the equipment first and then we go look into deriving some of the equations for it. So let's take a look at that. There's many dryers available, and the main distinction is typically on batch versus continuous. So batch dryers are low volume dryers. Continuous dryers is clearly on high capacity systems where you need that continual drying occurring. So pharmaceutical, specialty chemicals, you'll always see batch dryers. The next distinction we make, so you can take batch versus continuous dryers, and within both categories, you can apply your heat directly. So you provide convective heat, or you can provide indirect heat, so by microwaves or radiation to supply that energy. And then the next distinction one can make is whether you move your solids or keep them stationary. Okay, so we'll look at examples of all of these. So the most typical dryer is what we call a tray dryer or a shelf dryer. Our example that we'll look at maybe we'll get a chance to introduce it in today's class, but we'll solve it tomorrow, is a tray dryer. We've covered that mostly. I'll cover that as I talk about the different examples. So tray dryers we'll look at tomorrow, but here's the next one, is a tunnel dryer. And it's similar to a tray dryer. What we have is, we have what are called trucks, or just simply trays. So think of rectangular trays with your solids placed into them. And these then are placed on a conveyor, or they're moved in some way. And they move continually through the system. So they're moving, in this instance, the trays are moving in this direction, while my air is moving counter-current. So solids in that tray are moving from left to right. My air, however, is moving from right to left. So I'm moving my air in a counter-current fashion to the solids. I could move it co-current as well. There's examples of both. Okay. So you've got these tubes. You're seeing the cross-section here. These are simple tubes carrying steam. And I'm moving air across that, heating that air up. There's my blower to provide the movement. And that hot air circulates around, and my solids move from left to right. So when this truck or tray gets to the end, it's removed from the dryer, and a new one is placed. So this can operate continuously, but it's still kind of like a batch. You've got a batch of solids moving through there and leaving, but the system operates on a continual basis. You don't stop to add a new tray. New trays can be added without shutting the equipment down.
So you
said
steam, but you mean the steam is going through those heaters that feeds the dryer?
Yeah, so it's a bank of tubes. So if you looked at it from this end on, you'd simply see a whole lot of tubes. And you're blowing your air over those tubes, Another option we can consider is simply a conveyor belt, and you're blowing your hot air through the conveyor. So think of a mesh type conveyor with small openings on that mesh. And your particles here are large enough so that they don't fall through the mesh. And you simply blow the air through that conveyor, and the solids leave on a dry basis at the end. Yes, Richard.
How does the air start?
Yeah, there is an exit for the air. Air in, air out. Yeah, you'll see on a tray dryer in another example. Now, when we're talking about conveyors and solids on these conveyors, if you're thinking of granular material when it's dry will typically shrink and break up. So you still have to account for that as well when you choose your mesh size. And another thing that companies will do is, if this is very granular material, they'll pelletize it ahead of time. So if you think of, the easiest example I can think of is, think of your tablets. Any tablets that you might take, headache tablets, or think of dog food, cat food, those are pellet sizes, so they'll push the solids into a pellet and form that pellet, and those wet pellets then get dried, so that by the end it retains the size, it doesn't fall through the mesh. Here's another example where we're moving the solids around now. So notice on these two cases, the solids are pretty stationary. Once they're on the tray or once they're on the conveyor, the solids don't move. And that's fine for solids which won't break up. But this is used for solids that need gentle movement. For solids that are fine, for example, sands, we don't care if the sand gets moved around and breaks up a little bit, and fibers, we can rotate them around. And this rotation allows the mass transfer to occur more efficiently. We can get the moisture away, from that surface by this rotation. Now these tubes can be fairly long in length, and the residence time that the material spends in the tube can be fairly substantial. And it operates on a continual basis as well. We don't have to stop and start. So here's, I found a video of this, drying palm fibers. So this is like a fabric. So the residence time is in the order of about, of the systems typically is between 5 minutes and 2 hours.
Which is all they need now.
This is actual speed. This video is 2 minutes, and it's just 2 minutes of this happening. Okay, that's really helpful. So you'll notice these protrusions inside the dryer are there to lift the solids up, to encourage this movement, to throw them over, and to move them up along the side. So sometimes the solids can move pretty much most of the way up along the edge, tumble out, and that removes some of the moisture. Hot air is blowing from one point at the entry site all the way over, and then these veins in the interior are spiraled, so that moves the solids from the beginning to the exit.
So
this is a continual operating process for large quantities of.
Sorry?
This one I can't judge because the beginning and the end of the video doesn't give me any frame of reference to go on. But typical diameters are listed over there, 0.3 to 7 meters in diameter. If you YouTube if you search on YouTube for rotary spray, rotary dryers, there's some pretty horrific videos of some people operating these in a very unsafe manner. So I don't plan to show them here in the class, but you can then get an idea of size. Some other dryers that we can find are, again, operating on a continual basis. You've got a rotating drum. Inside the drum, you feed steam. That steam condenses on the edge of the drum. So that steam condensing from vapor to liquid, that heat has to go somewhere. That heat goes to drying the solid. Okay. And then that solid is, this looks exactly like our filtration drums we saw earlier. When you spread your solid over that drum surface very finely, that heat, that's the condensation of the steam on the inside, that heat is moving through the drum, and then the rotation is slow enough to dry the solids to a particular point that's required. And then that knife here on the edge removes the solid off. You can also feed your slurry on the center of two drums that are rotating counter to each other, and get the capacity. So this is good for products that can be, that your final presentation is in the form of chips or flakes. So many food products can be dried in this way. Here's an interesting one that you see in the pharmaceutical industry particularly. You also, any product that you buy that's in the form of very fine pellets, so laundry detergents, so powdered laundry detergents. Not liquid, the powdered laundry detergent. If you look at those particles, they're very, very uniform in size. Fertilizer pellets. How did they get those pellets so perfectly sized? Well, they don't have a machine making a small little circle, spherical pellets of the same size. They atomize it. So what you do is you take your pump, your slurry, liquid and solid being pumped through here, and you spray it through a very fine opening into the air at high velocity, and you provide just around that point at the exit very hot air provided by this furnace, and that atomized solid gets dried into almost perfectly spherical particles. And so used for detergents, milk powder, fertilizer pellets, and provides a very uniform shape. A lot of engineering goes into just designing that pump over there with a solid sleeve pump. So many different shapes, many patents and intellectual property around the design of those dryers. So here's another video that is quite interesting. It's very hard to see actually what goes on in here, but the guy's voiceover is informative.
What you are seeing is a pulse combustion spray dryer in action.
At the top center of the picture, you can see the feed material entering the dryer vertically. Although you cannot see it, hot air is also entering the dryer chamber at the same location and in the same direction. The hot air is traveling at about 400 miles per hour and is at a temperature of 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit. As you can see, the high velocity air instantly atomizes the liquid and the heat drives off the water. Soon, you can see powder floating around the drying chamber before it exits at the bottom. The extreme turbulence in the atomization zone allows for nearly instantaneous drying, and even though the inlet temperature is very high, there is no scorching because evaporative cooling keeps the particle temperature at or below the wet bulb temperature of the drying chamber. The result? Very efficient drying and very high powder quality. Also, because the liquid feed is introduced through a straight pipe at very low pressure, the pulse dryer can handle very viscous liquids, even those containing solid particles, without clogging of the atomizer. Shazam!
Yeah, so then that's collected down there. You then this you separate out the solids from liquids. Many systems will also have a cyclone there, right there to do this. So here they use a bag filter. You can use a cyclone now to separate your hot air from the solids that you just created. And so here's a final one that you can see is a fluidized air dryer. Here your solid is fed from the top on a conveyor belt into the fluidized bed. The fluidized bed has counter current flowing air upwards, so here's my air inlet, I heat it up and then feed it through this header point. My air goes up, my solids go down and dries out in that way. So fluidized bed, very, very careful control of those flow rates are required to get just the right amount of residence time so you get the drying required. So whenever I've worked through that beds, the hardest thing for the company to control is those temperatures and the residence times. So you get, you don't overdry your solids and burn them. So your solids are coming down here, they're moving up and down in the air. And if the residence time is too long, you can overdry your solids, and that can lead to deterioration of your product, or you can also obviously underdry your solid. So we've actually spoken about this in an earlier class. This principle that's being used in the fluidized bed dryer is elutriation. You've got your container over here and you've got your particle and you've got the Stokes law applies. If the velocities are low enough, then you can have your this particle balance just right. So your velocity of your air flowing up counteracts the gravity on that particle. You've got buoyancy courses as well. So remember back to the derivation, right at the start of this course, we looked at the forces acting on a spherical particle. So if you get your velocity up just right, you can keep those particles in suspension long enough. Obviously, you don't want to keep them suspended there. You want the velocity so that that particle gradually travels down, but stays in the dryer long enough to get to a point of the dryer that's required. Nor do you want, the other thing is, of course, you don't want your velocity so fast that you blow all your solids out the top. Now, some of your solids will go out the top because, if you think of your solids drying, you don't have all your solids at one particle diameter. You're going to have a distribution of diameters. So your smaller particles will go out the top. Your larger particles will drop. And so you want to recover your larger particles here in the cyclone. Those get captured in the vortex, and those finer solids then reported to the same conveyor out here. This stream leaving the overflow from the cyclone should mostly be hot air, and then you can either exhaust that or recycle it in the system. So here, if we're drying water off our solids, what's leaving out here in the exhaust is water vapor. But in many cases, what you're drying off are solvents and undesirable compounds that you can't just vent into the atmosphere. So that exhaust stream will often get recycled, condensed, and you recover that solvent, maybe valuable as well. In the case of water, we we don't have an environment concerning putting that into the plants, provided it's free of the salts. Now the nice thing is, with fluidized beds, is that you get very good mixing in both the fluidized beds and the spray dryer, as the voiceover had said in the video. You get some really good mixing and turbulent flow in there, so a lot of good heat transfer and mass transfer occurring very quickly, very efficiently. Whereas if you think of those earlier dryers, there's long times required because the mixing is much, much slower. Okay, so let me perhaps leave this for the next class because it all hangs together. I just wanted to show what a tray dryer looks like finally. We'll talk about this example next time, but here's a tray dryer. It's simply a batch system where you load your solids onto trays, you dry to completion, empty out the dryer, and you restart again. So in the next class group, we'll derive a problem and calculate how long you need to operate for to get the desired amount of dryer.